especially to those of you who are joining us at the gallery for the first time. We thank you for taking time out of your busy lives to spend the afternoon with us. And we're extremely honored to have EJ here at her beautiful work, beautifying our gallery space. I'm Myrtis Vidola. I'm the founding director of Galerie Myrtis and president, and Alex Hyman is the vice president. Website developer, everything extraordinaire. This afternoon, we're going to explore the life of EJ Montgomery. And I thought it would be interesting to explore who she was before she graced us with her presence here on the East Coast. I mean, a lot of us know of her esteemed career as curator, arts administrator, mentor, I mean the list goes on, responsible for sending numerous artists abroad through the State Department. And I know that many, including myself, are indebted to her for her knowledge and experience that she willfully shares with everyone. I want to start with reading an excerpt from an article written by Dr. Floyd Coleman, titled Explorations of Identity and Cultural Memory, The Art and Life of E.J. Montgomery. E.J. Juliet Montgomery, or E.J. as she is now fondly known to artists, curators, and scholars, has an inevitable record, of achievement as an arts administrator in the museum world and in arts and cultural agencies across the United States and throughout the Americas, Europe, Asia, and Africa. For more than 35 years, Montgomery has worked tirelessly to support and promote artists through curating their work and supporting artists' exhibitions and their travel abroad. She has curated over more than 200 exhibitions, has supervised the organization of numerous others, and has recognized and extolled the pluralist nature of American civilization and its indebtedness to Native Americans, Africans, Asians, and Europeans. So with that, EJ, I know that you had your first oil painting kit at the age of 14. And so what I wanted to know is, since or the beginning of your work and where you began and your expression as yourself as an artist, tell us about your early work as an artist.
Yes, in my lower grades in school, I did the usual thing. In fact, I described one of these works over here as being created the same as you did in first grade or so. Teacher gave you a potato, and you made marks on the potato, and you take a fork and scrubbing lines in it, or a knife, or some kind of a blade, and chipping away at little pieces of it, and then taking the potato and dipping it in the water-based paint, and then dipping that design, placing that design in the middle of the sheet of paper you were given, and you probably handed it to your mother on Mother's Day and said, here's your Mother's Day. So I did a lot of things like that in the early years. And in junior high, I had an instructor that loved bottles of some type, and she would bring various bottles to school. I know now that a lot of them are wine bottles. And we painted little flowers and things like that on them. And I was so good at it that she had me make all of her Christmas gifts, I'm sure. So there were things like that that I did in the early days. And I played with paper dolls, and I made clothing designs. for my paper dolls. That was probably my earliest artwork. And then, as I said, when I was 14, I remember getting this oil painting set. And I was living in New York City then, and it was a terrible snowstorm at Christmas time that season. And I began painting with my set right away.
And as your work progressed and you became more serious about your art, which artists do you think had the greatest influence on you as a young artist?
Well, I don't remember any of them at that time. My earliest date was like in high school. I could have gone to the High School of Music and Art, which was popular in New York at the time, because that same junior high school teacher saved some of my drawings and things and wanted to put a portfolio together for me to try to enter music and art. But my mother didn't feel that that was where I needed to be. She felt that I needed a more academic program. And she really did not take the time to find out that much about the music and art high school and its program. So anyway, I didn't go there, and I went to a regular high school that also offered a lot of art. And in the end, I took quite a few art classes in that school. I did have friends that went to the High School of Music and Art. And one evening, I remember going to a meeting of black artists, older men mostly. And I sat through the meeting, and I remember Alvin Hollingsworth, who was a New York artist, deceased now, was at that meeting. And he, at the time, was doing a lot of cartoons and designing comic books. And he also worked for a magazine called Our World Magazine, very similar to Evangeline. And so that's the one name that I remember from that group of people, but I'm sure now that there were many well-known names there. I also used to do a lot of swimming and hanging out at the YMCA and the 134th Street Bathhouse and the 135th Street YMCA building. And I know that there were artists there and photographers. And I ended up doing some sitting for the photographers, mostly coming out of the bathhouse, my hair soaking wet, and
So what would you say was the pivotal moment when you knew that you wanted to become an artist, and that was the life that you really wanted to commit yourself to?
Well, after I got married and whatnot, I was living in Boston, and I was working as an artist, you might say, painting religious statuary and things like that. But I don't know, I decided that I wanted to go to college, and at that point, art major without any art classes, because by the time I got there and my name came up, the classes were all filled. So the first year that I was in college, I didn't have any art classes.
And again, what was the name of the college you attended?
Los Angeles City College. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty well known. In fact, I would hang around the art building, and many well-known musicians in the Los Angeles area were there in school taking classes. And Les McCann was one of the people that was there, and I remember him. Used to go to hear him a lot.
And so let's step outside of your role as an artist for a moment and look at one of the exhibitions that really was seminal in your career, and that is the one that you curated of Sergeant Johnson's work, which was a retrospective. So how did you come to know him?
Well, by that time I'd been living in the Bay Area, San Francisco, and around the corner from where I live, there was a black bookstore. And Sergeant used to go into that bookstore quite often, and I didn't know about him, but I ended up in the bookstore one day talking to him, the owner, and Sergeant was an enamelist, a sculptor who did enamels on metal and various types of sculpture work. Ceramics and woodwork, metalwork. And so I also, along the way, had learned to do enamels on metal and for a time worked in that field too. So we got to talking about enamels, and he said, would I like to see some of his work? And I said, yes. So he brought some of his enamels and put them in the window of the bookstore where I could see them day and night. And we talked often about the work. And that's how I came to know him. But it was rather short-lived because he died not too long after.
So was he alive at the point that the retrospective took place?
No. And I had to find all the people who were collectors of his work, mm-hmm. his friends and whatnot in the Bay Area. He was very active with the group who worked in the WPA projects, and he did some major works in the Bay Area that still exist. A great deal of work in the Maritime Museum in San Francisco. He did the frontal frieze and several other parts of the museum, indoors and outdoors.
And how did that experience shape your curatorial path?
Well, actually, I'd like to share with you something that in 1968 there was an exhibition at the Oakland Museum called New Perspectives in Black Art. And I was the person who organized this and organized the artists and whatnot. I'd like to pass this book around. It's the only one I have. So please let find its way back here. In 1968, there was also a major exhibit in New York, which Romare Bearden and other people were responsible for putting together. And the message did not go across the country that that was going on, or that our show was going on the West Coast. But it was the second large exhibition to be shown on the West Coast. The first one was organized by a curator from UCLA, and it was shown in four places in Northern California. And it was a national exhibition of black artists' works. And then as soon as that ended, soon after that, I met the people at the Oakland Museum, the director, and other people in the community, and they realized that we had organized a Black Artists Group Association, and we came together for this exhibition, New Perspectives in Black Art. At that time, I said that Black people in the community want to know their artists. And with that, I was able to talk the museum into this exhibition. And it was very, very well attended. We got all of the colleges and universities in the area to participate in some way, either with speakers or exhibitions and various things like that, at the same time as the show was going on in the museum. We also have held this exhibition during the month of October, when school children could be bused in to see the exhibit. And there were many things like that that we were able to do with this exhibition. And the whole community became involved, and particularly faculty in the universities. And
so what would you suggest is part of the important role that the curator plays in its relationship with the artist and in also in shaping art history?
Well, the curator is really the most important, to feel out the community, to see what their needs are, what their interests are, and also to interact with the people who raise money in the community or who are in charge of the education system, to see that this is included in the program of the school. At the same time, in 1968, was when the Black Studies began, and that happened also in the Bay Area. The original people formulating those ideas around Black Studies were there, and was going on there. And part of, once this show was held, by the spring of the year, the next year, many of the schools were asking for, if they had some type of Black Studies program starting up, then they wanted to have a festival week. And as part of festival week, they wanted to have an art exhibit. And so they came to our group and asked us to get involved with them to start it. So we had many, many shows in the next 4 or 5, 10 years in the schools.
And so do you think that that helped to bring recognition to the artist in the community and also to kind of move their careers forward,
yes,
in a sense?
It did that. And we were dealing with professional artists too. We found not only those that were teaching, but people who were working in other fields as artists.
So let's look at your work then as an artist and talk a little bit about your experiences recently. And that is that, I'm going to skip the question about your exhibition, I'm going to come back to that. But I want to talk to you about your experience in working with two printmaking facilities this year, or printmaking organizations, which were Lily Press and Brandywine, because I know we have several artists joining us today. And so, two different organizations. I wanted to know if you could tell us what the experience was like in terms of its differences and its similarities.
Well, Lily Press is a press that's owned by one person, an artist, white artist in the area, who's worked with several presses. And we can rent time and space with her, in that she will work with you to create your image, wherever it is. And you know, you pay a fee for the time that you're there with various things. It's very well set up. It's in the press is in the back of her home, and so you have to work with the family as well. And it's a nice atmosphere. The press is working with the various types of printmaking, litho, etchings, and so on. The paper, the inks, and all of that are supplied by the press. Brandywine is a different setup. They're working with offset lithography and lithography, as well as silkscreen. They can provide, there is a possibility of them providing other techniques. They have equipment in the building, but it's not set up right now. But it's a larger facility, and several people can be working there at the same time. They provide the helpers and the equipment, all the equipment.
So you are a woman artist creating non-representational art, abstract work, in mostly a male-dominated genre. For some reason, there appears to be more men who are abstract expressionists than women. So I wondered if you could describe one of your greatest triumphs as being a female abstract artist. I know you're too humble, but come on, there's something there right now.
Well, the thing is that I work in many different media.
Mm-hmm.
I work with prints, and this was not a new thing. Some people thought it was, but years ago in California, I worked with prints and whatnot, and so, you know, 20, 30 years passed. And here I am back in printmaking. But I also began my studies in the craft area, silkscreen on fabric, and weaving textiles. So if you notice, a lot of my work is small patterns are repeated. And that comes from the beginning areas when I worked in fiber.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, what did you ask me?
Well, you talked about female abstract artists, which I don't know if that's altogether true anymore. I think there's a plethora of women of color, and particularly white female artists, perhaps abstractionists, but the ones that have gained the greatest recognition, may in fact be male.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. And I know that there are other women, but it appears
yeah.
to be a male-dominated form, and I know that she's not the only female that operates within that form. And I, in part, was referring to the essay written by Sharon Patton, and I'm going to draw from her essay and also from that of Barry Gaither. And in Patton's essay, she addressed the notion that, and I'm quoting, a history of African American art presupposes that race and gender automatically predetermine the subject matter of African American artists. As an artist, you have operated outside of the visual norms. Your work does not subscribe to figurative or racialized imagery often attributed to African American art. And so, I guess then the question is, do you consider yourself an abstract expressionist?
Well, I wouldn't say I'm an abstract expressionist, but I do work in abstract art. And because I think that my work relates more to pattern.
Mm-hmm.
And students at Hans Hoffman and people like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was also in the Bay Area where there was a lot of Zen thought, in my opinion. You know, instructors that I had were involved in that. I had Asian instructors as well. And, you know, we talked about the Asian philosophy.
And I guess I'm asking more about the abstract because that's what we have here. But there are other, if you have an opportunity to visit, and I'm suggesting that you all take time to see the wonderful exhibition at Morgan, there are other forms of EJ's work there, including her beautiful boxes and an installation piece. So that's what's mostly I'm addressing here is the work as it's represented here in the gallery space.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Gaither cited three goals which emerged during the black art movement in the late 60s. They were, one, make the art of African American artists known and appreciated. Two, secure opportunities for African American artists. And three, build scholarship and documentation that would establish African American art within American art. And so I'm going to take each one of those questions and ask how you've contributed to each of those. So one, how do you believe, or what do you believe to be the way in which you contributed to making African American art known and appreciated?
Well, I think I've spent all my waking hours almost.
Yes.
And that every place I've been, I've tried to promote the African American art. In the Bay Area, when we had this Youth Perspectives in Black Art exhibition, we had a panel discussion on opening night. And, you know, one of the participants said that when he meets a good black artist, then he would show one in his gallery. And things like that, they dare to make those kinds of statements in a room of 400 people who, you know, moaned and groaned at that and swore that they'd never go inside of his gallery, things like that. But I tried in every way I could to not just bring other artists along with my thinking to open doors for them, but also the community. And I tried to devote as much time as I could in promoting art in the community.
Yeah, I wanted to see a show of hands of those joining us today who you've mentored, influenced, given of yourself and your time to. So can we see some hands here?
wanted to say, I think EJ's being kind of humble because
I know.
She's not telling the whole story.
At all.
EJ was the first art commissioner in San Francisco. It was a non-paying position, and she was appointed to that position. So she influenced a whole lot of people in the Bay Area. And then also has her job with the State Department, where she's an artist all around the world. And I was just at a talk Margot Humphrey gave at University of Delaware just last month, and she talked about how E.J. Montgomery influenced her career, not just her artwork, but her entire career by sending her to various places around the world where she was able to absorb various cultures and then translate that into her artwork. And that's how she progressed. So EJ has had a profound effect, not just on, you know, on Afro-American art in general. I mean, she has done so much for so many artists and so many artists' careers. So she's just being very humble.
I know. I'm trying to draw information out of her, and she made me promise I wouldn't be asking tough questions, but that's the root of what I'm trying to get at, is the depth and breadth of what she's done for the art, American art, African American art history through her curatorial exhibitions, the exhibitions she's curated, through the artists who she sent abroad, which we touched on a little bit ago. And for people like me, I'm not an artist, but if I need help with something, I call EJ, you know, I talk to her. And I visited her place, and it's just so wonderful to see her art collection, her peers, the people that she has come along, you know, their art experiences have been shared. And then the work itself is just so profound. So she sits before us very humble, as she always is, but we have this brilliant person in front of us who has touched so many lives and been so generous of her time and forthcoming with information. And as we know, a lot of people are not like that. It's like, you know, you get it your own way. I don't have time. Time is money, and I won't get a dime if I sit down and spend 3 hours sitting to talk with you, which she did the afternoon I went to be with her. So, you know, she is a diamond in the rough. And so I'm going to get back to my questions and pull some more information out, because we're going to post this video so that people who were not able to be with us today will have a greater sense of who E.J. Montgomery is all across the world. And so that's what we're going to pose some more questions to you, E.J., and get some more information out of you. And in terms of securing opportunities for African American artists, let's talk a little bit about what you've done through the State Department.
Well, as part of my duties there was to work with American exhibitions and send them abroad. As the cultural presentations that we offer in different countries. Some of the exhibitions had 3 or 4 venues, and some had as many as 30 venues. That's showings in different parts of the world. The exhibitions were all types of exhibits, from craft to, we sent a craft today exhibition to 15 different venues in Europe, and there were 250 items of the leading craftsmen of the day. And in that was only 3 African Americans out of 250. But the 3 were there, and excellent work and major artists. We had Brandywine had 2 exhibitions, I believe, that traveled in different parts of the world. and they went to almost 50 venues between the two exhibitions. And most of the artists were African Americans in the Brandywine exhibition. Smell Lewis curated two Jacob Lawrence exhibitions that went to Latin America and the Caribbean area and Africa. She also curated an exhibition of Richard Hunt's that went to Africa. And he made his first trip to Africa. He was broken.
By Sam Gilliam.
Yes, Sam Gilliam went to, he did four installations in different parts of the world. And they were the draped fabric things that he does. And then he started five installations in East Asia. And one of the places was in Taiwan. In Taiwan, she was shown in a brand new museum. And 17 Taiwanese artists did installations in and around the exhibition that she put up in that museum. So when the artists go out, they've had an opportunity to interact with local artists as well as the museum world and the general public. There were at least 50 artists during the course of the year that went out to give workshops and lectures on the way. There was an exhibition at Pyramid Atlantic and four other Mid-Atlantic print workshops were involved in, and there was 77 artists, I believe, in that show that went around to quite a few places. But in each place that the exhibit was shown, two American artists went over and stayed about 2 weeks giving workshops and the type of print techniques that they were involved in. Well, we sent people like Roy DiCarava, the photographer, to East Asia. At the same time, Paul Caponegro, a white artist, was in Europe with his photography. I'm Jim Cunningham, who died at age 96, who was still working right up until her death. Her work went overseas, and she was shown in about 30 different venues. And her granddaughter made a video that was shown with her show. And it just goes on and on like that. I worked with more than 50 exhibitions over 25 years that went to different parts of the world.
And in terms of...
I wanted to add something.
Yes.
Frida High wrote an extensive article on EJ dealing with just this aspect of her career and how hopefully it will be published soon. And properly in an academic journal. But what the essence of what she was saying is how EJ had an inclusive aesthetic of making sure women and artists of color were always represented during the time when that wasn't the norm. And also that there was a the type of work that she presented was experimental, aesthetically tough, and presenting them in areas that they weren't familiar with these artists, the type of work these artists were presenting. She worked in crafts. She worked a lot with works on paper and printmaking. I think there were two areas that she made substantial contributions in terms of the types of exhibitions that she put together. And I don't know if you want to talk about Joyce Wellman and Goldman, and were several artists who worked with women in one in East Africa.
I think Joyce went to Kenya.
And, right. And
sent
Joyce Wellman went to Kenya. And she worked with women artists from all over East Africa. I think there were about 15 or 20 of them that lived together in a campsite and worked together for 2 or 3 weeks. And shared a lot of information.
And who was the name of the Persian artist with the crying wall? Just a fantastic story that she told.
Lebanese. It's a young lady who lives in Washington, D.C. She went to Palestine and worked with a group of women artists there.
Was that Helen?
Yes, for 4 weeks, and it was an incredible experience that she had, and that they had.
Culture shock.
Yeah,
I think the way she described it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it appears that the opportunities you provided these artists through the State Department that enriched their lives,
yes,
in many ways, and.
Martha Jackson Jarvis went to Tajikistan and worked with artists there, and one has already come to visit her and stayed with she and her family for 7 years.
So the third part of Gaither's goal was the documentation that would establish African American art within American art. And I wondered how you feel that you've contributed to that.
Well, I feel I've tried. Very few people have asked me to write anything. I'm not a writer, really. But in Helene Lotta's book on collecting African American art, there is a small and written by me, to a couple of pages or so, about globalization art and participation.
I've read some of it that you've written.
So. Mm-hmm. But there's room for more, and I'm not working on a book or anything, but someone is working on something on me.
Several people.
Yeah, I mean,
so
you're a walking encyclopedia of African American art and American art history. So,
well, the whole business of the exhibitions, I've been very interested in trying to promote that end of things. And I've worked with museum people, both black and white organizations, to try to improve their exhibition policies and programs. And many of the blacks who are in the business and have been in the business for 30 years or so are still working with an outline that I've given out that early on as to how to do an exhibition. And the one thing I try to encourage artists to, you make the art, but you need somebody to write about you. And you need to make those kind of associations early on in your career to find those that will write and maintain those friendships and keep them involved and aware of your progress and what you're doing at all times. Um,
let's talk a little bit about the exhibition at Morgan State University. This is a catalog with many beautiful essays written by the curator and Dr. Patton and Barry Gaither. Did you want to say that?
No, I was just going to say, give background, and maybe it would be helpful to know who's who. Sharon Payne Patton was the ex-director of the National Museum of African Art. Barry Gaither is the executive director and founder of the National Museum of African American Art in Boston. And Shirley Woodson runs the NCA Galerie and organization out of Detroit. And so long, all, and I am an independent curator and writer. I've known EJ since 1994.
Can you tell everyone
when
you turn
on? Oh, my name is A.A. Weaver. I curated the show at Morgan. I've known EJ since 94. I do want to recount how we met each other. I came up with a colleague, and we were involved in a pleasant conversation. An issue of abstract painters came up, and I ended up sitting down for 2 hours writing a notebook full of notes about all the artists that were active in abstraction throughout the country. So that was my first orientation to EJ. And this is my second go-round with sort of documenting her more recent work since the 90s. It was another project called Configurations of Memories. And that preceded this one by about almost a decade, didn't it?
The exhibition is absolutely beautiful and beautifully curated.
Thank you.
It's really, really wonderful. So I encourage you all to go if you haven't and grab a catalog, because the essays in the catalog really do what they should, and that is to put EJ and her work into historic context. So they were very well done. So tell us about your experience, EJ, the exhibition, how do you feel about it, the work that's there, and working with the AM to get that done.
I think it's a variety of work, and I'm pleased that it's showing more recent work, and I think it's a good show for students to observe because of the different techniques, and I'm interested in nature and those kinds of things, and I think some of that comes out in the show. And my feeling about color and design is strong in the show. And I've also reached back into my craft area a bit, and I have something that I started making years ago called Ancestral Boxes. And so I finally was able to do the one thing I wanted to do with the Ancestral Box, was to build boxes big enough that the community could get involved in the box. And that's placing things of importance that you want to share with the community, whatever that may be. And in this case, we built a box, and people are going to place things in it, students, and they will become the property of the school, the box and the contents.
Did you want to add anything more about the exhibition or your experience in working with EJ?
Well, we spent a lot of time talking to each other on the phone, and I probably drove her nuts in going over the work and getting the titles together and making the selection process. But hopefully she had enough time and energy to focus on making the work, which was part of the process. You know, as the administrative stuff went on, as it went on, you know.
So lastly, let's just talk a little bit about the work that's here in the gallery. The inspiration for it and
sort of began using these marks that are like my own language. And I'm not copying any particular language, but I'm just putting these shapes together. And I feel that I'm coming up with the color from landscape and soil use. In California and around the Bay Area, or just below the Bay Area, is an area called Carmel, California. And it's along the water. And the wildflowers grow on those hills there. And there's also an area where butterflies are hatched at a certain date and time. And you happen to be there, it's the most fabulous thing you ever see. These butterflies just everywhere. So there are areas like that, and there's also a place called 17 Mile Drive, which is along the ocean, and there is a lot of brush along the waterfront and in between the rocks. And I do a lot of photographing there. And people like Ansel Adams and whatnot photographed in that area too, called Big Sur. And that's where I've gotten a lot of my inspiration from. For my work.
One of the questions I didn't pose earlier that I'm interested to know is, who do you consider your peers in terms of the arts?
Well, Samuel Lewis and Sam Gilliam, Richard Mayhew,
Bill Hudson.
And then when I lived in the Bay Area, I had two friends, Arthur Monroe and Arthur Carraway. Arthur Carraway is deceased now. The two of them used to sort of hang out with me, and we talked days about art. And one of Arthur Monroe's works have just given to the museum at Morgan. At least I placed it on extended loan. It's a large piece and it's up now. It's in the lobby area of the gallery.
And you and Samuel Lewis, Dr. Lewis, are still very close friends, aren't
yes.
you?
Yes, we talk every day. Cheryl Woodson from Detroit, we talk every day. And Arthur has just retired, and he doesn't know when to stop talking. It's worse now. So, but Arthur has lived quite an interesting life and been around a lot of musicians and things of that nature. And he was also a museum person. He worked at the Oakland Museum as the registrar of the art. And they have thousands of works there. And so he's had quite an interesting experience and knows all the artists in the Bay Area and everybody's business who collects and whatnot.
Yes.
So he makes for an interesting person.
Well, at this time, I want to open up the floor for questions. Does anyone have any questions for EJ?
I do. I'm very curious about the new journey piece.
This one?
Yes.
Well, this sort of speaks for itself, I think. But I've also started doing more collage.
Right.
I've learned not to throw anything away.
It just looks so strategically placed where you put the collage elements. There are two major elements and then the horizon line, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
EJ, can you talk about, you know, you used to do these sterling boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Could you talk about that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my metalsmithing work came very early on in my college career. It was weaving and metal. And I worked in jewelry and then finally in the metalsmithing, making silver bowls and boxes, things of that nature, mostly in silver. I did not concentrate on jewelry, which a lot of people talk about me as a jeweler, but I made just enough jewelry to get through to say that yes, I made jewelry. But I joined also an organization called the Metal Arts Guild in Northern California, which was a very important guild of older artists that are very well known in the field. And the person I studied with was Hudson Rorschach, who made these whole processional material that they use in the Catholic churches and whatnot, and also the whole altar that's made of metal and whatnot. So I studied with him, and in his classes were people who did the same kind of work, and they were members of the Metal Arts Guild. So I had the opportunity to get to know a lot of these people, although I didn't do the amount of work and production that they did. I was around them. And I did enameling, as I said, I didn't do any work with Sargent Johnson, but looked at a lot of his work. But I also did some parts of pieces that were fitted into my professor's work, some enamel sections. And that was done 40 years ago. So.
You've worked in a number of different media. Which did you enjoy working in the most and why? Which did you not enjoy working?
I think I enjoyed the enameling the most and wish that I had more time to put into that. And I continue to look for time. Napoleon Jones Henderson started the enameling, and he and I are friends, and we always talk about, well, let's get together and do some work. And that might happen sometime soon. There's another young lady in this area, Helen Elliott.
Yes.
And she and I have talked about getting together. But I did enjoy the enameling. There are as many colors in enamel as there is in the paint and whatnot. And it's just rather exciting to see what you can do with something in the hot furnace and pull it right out again.
Any other questions? Any questions?
I'd like to add that I believe that hopefully at last a lot of people who did not know you and know what you've done through the years, you've been like the driving force and the backbone of a lot of artists, helping them with their careers as well as making sure their work has been seen. You have been like the specials on Sergeant Johnson, and one of our experiences, we were at Michael Rosenfeld in New York, and I'm sorry, I got a new phone, I don't even know how to play it off. But we were in Michael Rosenfeld's gallery, and he did not know she was there, and he had some Sergeant Johnsons in there. And so EJ had exhibited several of the pieces in the collection. And so I'm always really excited, so I was running around, and EJ has a habit of, like, she likes to pick up things. And I remember my first Sergeant Johnson piece, which must weigh 100-some pounds, and she tried to pick it up to look at the bottom of it, and I almost broke my neck trying to grab it from her. And we both almost fell over because it was so heavy. But we, the young lady in the gallery did not want, you know, EJ's Parkinson's, which is an amazing fact that she still is doing so much work and she has Parkinson's. And the lady did not want EJ to pick up the piece of art. And so, of course, I became indignant. I'm like, this is the authority on Sergeant Johnson. What are you talking about? Anyway, Mike Rosenfeld found out that EJ was there and stopped what he was doing, came out, grabbed his papers, some papers, and came out and says, EJ, I still have these papers that you published on Sergeant Johnson, and I use this when I'm authenticating pieces, and pieces that you've shown in the past and everything. But EJ has been very instrumental, and she's a really serious artist, and she has finally come to her own, and she's being seen as the great artist, which she really is, and the diversity, the metal work, the enamel, the silver boxes, the etchings, the paintings, the acrylic paintings, and now the collages, and just shows her diversity. And this year alone, she has worked out of 5 different venues. She's worked with Michael Platt, Susan Goldman, Curly Holton. She's worked with Brandywine. And she's just been really, really working, and I'm really proud of her, and for people to give her the love that they've given her and the recognition it's never too late. So this is a wonderful opportunity, and thank you, Myrtis, for the opportunity as well.
We're honored to have her here, and this work is absolutely brilliant. It's really, really beautiful. It's really beautiful. Any other questions?
Yeah, I'd just like to ask, EJ, I heard you speak with some about the Climate as Art Commission in San Francisco, how, you were able to get as many black artists as possible to do shows and exhibits and so forth. Can you tell us a little bit about that time and, what was going on and how you were able to pull that off?
Well, as a commissioner, you can oftentimes there are new works being commissioned in the city, and San Francisco at the time was enlarging the airport, and so there was quite a few slots available there. They had a 2% law for city buildings, any buildings or parks or whatnot that were created, 2% would go towards art enrichment. And so there was quite a bit going on there. There was a new hospital at that time, as well as the airport. And I saw to it, as the person responsible for the art, the visual art part of the commission, to get some of the commissions for women artists, as well as African-American artists. There were 4 hub areas within the airport, and the first one was given to a woman artist. The second one was given to Fred Eversley, a black artist, and the other 2 slots were given to white male artists. So, but when you're in those positions, you have to You don't have to play your cards right with everybody to try to get across what you want. And I was able to do a lot of that. When you volunteer your time to be a commissioner, in this case it was appointed by the mayor, and by the way, that was the mayor that was killed in office, Mayor Moscone. And every morning, 9 o'clock, I was called by somebody at the commission to look at work, to make decisions, to go before the board of supervisors to argue a point as to why we should spend so much and so much money on this particular commission. And for instance, there was, for the airport, we decided that we would spend so much money, but once that decision was made, then going about which way to organize the participation of people to try to get the commissions was another whole thing, which spent a year on that alone. And there, in other words, when you accept these kind of positions, you're in it all the way. And there's no longer time for your need for yourself. Mm-hmm. You're only thinking about how to improve those conditions and how to get everyone involved. So.
Any other questions?
I'd like for you to add about the two things that Morgan, the exhibit at Morgan. You mentioned the ancestral box. Just tell them a little bit about the ancestral box and how when they visit that they should bring something and leave something there. And also mention something about your book that Morgan, your children's book that Morgan did.
That's another thing. Morgan, every exhibit that they're holding now, they are doing a children's book, if possible, on the exhibition. And so mine is about EJ, and EJ has a lot of nicknames and whatnot. But somehow she gets through all of that, and they tell her whole life story in about 30 pages. So, but it's very interesting, nice.
Has the book been published? Is it available?
It's being published now.
Okay.
And yes, you can sign up for, I think it's $10.
You can order it.
You can order it.
And then the box.
And the box is is now part of Morgan's property. It's about the size of a steamer trunk. And we're asking you, when you visit the box, that maybe you share some family photographs or letters or something like that. You may have a letter written to somebody from the president for some reason or other. You may want to make a copy of that and put it in an envelope with your name and address and share it with them. And these are things that students can then draw on later for various programs and projects that they may have.
And where is the box located? Is it
the box
the
is located in the middle of the exhibition.
Okay.
You can't miss it.
It's then, huge.
And in the catalog, there's an article about the importance of the box in your lifetime and mine. And I just like to see, you know, even if you have a club and your whole club goes to visit the exhibition, then encourage everybody to take something to share with the ancestral box.
Well, thank you.
thank you, EJ. I think we'll stop here. Everyone to take a look at the work. Please note that it is available for sale. We'd like to continue to support EJ and have some more refreshments and relax and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.
There's another sheet here that I wanted to share with you, that there have been two national exhibitions of craft work of African Americans, and this is the first one, the program from the first one. And David Driscoll was the curator of the exhibition that was held, and it was a week-long conference that was in Memphis, Tennessee in 1979, and the second one was held in Ohio about 10 years ago.
Is there anything else you want to share about this subject?
Well, just that at the same time that I was on the West Coast, I was having exhibitions here on the East Coast. And this is one that was at Bowie College and was traveling around.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Can
you
give
us
a
foundation?
Oh, the scholarship?
Yes. I was a member of Blacks in Government, which is all over the country. And my chapter is with the State Department. And they have, they were thinking of some ways to give scholarship, and they decided to name scholarship in my name, which once a year we've been giving 6 to 8 scholarships to high school students going into college, and they don't have to be the top scholar and whatnot, but be able to express their need and why and what they've done within their communities and all. And this is now the 6th annual one. And the monies are being raised through artist friends of mine have given their artwork for sale. 25% of the sale of the art goes towards the scholarship fund, and 75% goes to the arts. And we have time payment plan and so forth. And anybody who wants to know more about it, I can tell you personally about it, where you can go to see the art. And there are about 20 artists that have participated in this year.
Thank you.